short sleeve shirt. Last Saturday, a short sleeve shirt. Today?
Please.
No, I don't think so.
Nope.
No. Thanks for coming today.
Sure.
I'm Bob. Pastor Bob. I don't know what I did. Well, here.
Alright, how are you?
I am good, thank you.
I was here with Stan Boney one day, I think we did something.
That's right, I was passing out communion.
That's it.
That's right.
Yeah.
I remember that day. Let me just set my things up here.
What time are we starting here?
We're starting right now.
Right now?
Yeah.
Okay.
I'd like to welcome everyone to our Good Friday noon service in the parking lot, and welcome to those who are watching online on our Facebook page. I wanted to double check, have somebody wave to me to make sure that you're getting this over the radio feed. Okay, great, glad to see that. Our service, we gathered yesterday for the Lord's Supper on Monday, Thursday, and today we gather for the remembrance of the death of Christ on Good Friday. And we're going to begin today by singing from the violet-colored bulletin insert, the first hymn, Beneath the Cross of Jesus. Prophecy en route of this day, as I said last weekend, that over 300 prophecies are fulfilled just in the life and death and resurrection of Jesus, his first coming. And this, a couple of them are contained here in Isaiah 52 and 53. The scriptures and the readings we'll have today, we'll be having our organist, Nina, will be reading about half of it, and I'll read half of it to give us some variety in the voices. But we begin with Isaiah 52.
Behold, my servant shall act wisely. He shall be high and lifted up, and shall be exalted. As many were astonished at you, his appearance was so marred beyond human semblance, and his form beyond that of the children of mankind. So shall he sprinkle many nations. Kings shall shut their mouths because of him, for that which has not been told them they see, and that which they have not heard they understand. Who has believed what he has heard from us, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before him like a young plant, and like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, and no beauty that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And as one from whom men hide their faces, he was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace. And with his wounds we are healed.
All we, like sheep, have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed, and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shearers is silent, so he opened not his mouth. By oppression and judgment he was taken away, and as for his generation, who considered that he was cut off from the land of the living, stricken for the transgression of my people. And they made his grave with the wicked and with a rich man in his death, although he had done no violence, and there is no deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him, and he has put him to grief. When his soul makes an offering for guilt, he shall see his offspring, he shall prolong his days. The will of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. Out of the anguish of his soul, he shall see and be satisfied. By his knowledge shall the righteous one, my servant, make many to be accounted righteous, and he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore I will divide him a portion with the many, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he poured out his soul to death, and was numbered with the transgressors. Yet he bore the sins of many, and made intercession for the transgressors. As we hear this word of prophecy about the coming Messiah, about his death for our iniquities, his chastisement to bring us peace, his piercing for our transgression, we continue our service with our order of confession and forgiveness. Friends in Christ, within the community of faith, a community of the church, God never wearies of forgiving sin and giving us the peace of reconciliation. On this day, let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor and enter the Paschal celebration reconciled with God and with one another. We pause for a moment of silent reflection and self-examination. And together we confess our sins, most merciful God. We confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray. God of all mercy and grace, look with favor on your world for which your Son suffered death on the cross. Draw us to him. Grant us your salvation and bring us to eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our readings continue at this time with the story of Good Friday, beginning with the trial of Jesus before Pilate.
John 18:28-19, verse 16. Then they led Jesus from the house of Caiaphas to the governor's headquarters. It was early morning. They themselves did not enter the governor's headquarters, so they would not be defiled, but could eat the Passover. So Pilate went outside to them and said, "What accusation do you bring against this man?" They answered him, "If this man were not doing evil, we would not have delivered him over to you." Pilate said to them, "Take him yourselves and judge him by your own law." The Jews said to him, "It is not lawful for us to put anyone to death." This was to fulfill the word that Jesus had spoken, to show by what kind of death he was going to die. So Pilate entered his headquarters again and called Jesus and said to him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "Do you say this of your own accord, or did others say it to you about me?" Pilate answered, "Am I a Jew? Your own nation and the chief priests have delivered you over to me. What have you done?" Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, my servants would have been fighting, that I might not be delivered over to the Jews. But my kingdom is not from the world." Then Pilate said to him, "So are you a king?" Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. For this purpose I was born, and for this purpose I have come into the world, to bear witness to the truth. Everyone who is of the truth listens to my voice." Pilate said to him, "What is truth?" After he had said this, he went back outside to the Jews and told them, "I find no guilt in him. But you have a custom that I should release one man for you at the Passover. So do you want me to release to you the king of the Jews?" They cried out again, "Not this man, but Barabbas." Now, Barabbas was a robber.
Then Pilate took Jesus and flogged him. And the soldiers twisted together a crown of thorns and put it on his head and arrayed him in a purple robe. And they came up to him, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews," and struck him with their hands. Pilate went out again and said to them, "See, I am bringing him out to you that you may know that I find no guilt in him." So Jesus came out wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe. Jesus said to them, "Behold the man." When the chief priests and the officers saw him, they cried out, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" Pilate said to them, "Take him yourselves and crucify him, for I find no guilt in him." The Jews answered him, "We have a law, and according to that law, he ought to die because he has made himself the Son of God." When Pilate heard this statement, He was even more afraid. He entered his headquarters again and said to Jesus, "Where are you from?" But Jesus gave him no answer. So Pilate said to him, "You will not speak to me? Do you not know that I have authority to release you and authority to crucify you?" Jesus answered him, "You would have no authority over me at all unless it had been given you from above. Therefore, he who delivered me over to you has the greater sin." From then on, Pilate sought to release him, but the Jews cried out, "If you release this man, you are not Caesar's friend. Everyone who makes himself a king opposes Caesar." So when Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus out and sat down on the judgment seat at a place called the Stone Pavement, and in Aramaic, Gabbatha. Now it was the day of preparation of the Passover. It was the sixth hour. He said to the Jews, "Behold, your king." They cried out, "Away with him! Away with him! Crucify him!" Pilate said to them, "Shall I crucify your king?" The chief priests answered, "We have no king but Caesar." So he delivered him over to them to be crucified. We sing verse 2 of Go to Dark Gethsemane.
Jesus, and he went out bearing his own cross to the place called the place of a skull, which in Aramaic is called Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with him two others, one on either side, and Jesus between them. Pilate also wrote an inscription and put it on the cross. It read, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." Many of the Jews read this inscription, for the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Aramaic, in Latin, and in Greek. So the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate, "Do not write 'the King of the Jews,' but rather, 'This man said, I am King of the Jews.'" Pilate answered, "What I have written, I have written." When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his garments and divided them into four parts, one part for each soldier, also his tunic. But the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from top to bottom. So they said to one another, "Let us not tear it, but cast lots for it to see whose it shall be." This was to fulfill the scripture which says, "They divided my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots." So the soldiers did these things. But standing by the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to his mother, "Woman, behold your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Behold your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her to his own home.
After this, Jesus, knowing that all was now finished, said, to fulfill the scripture, "I thirst." A jar full of sour wine stood there, so they put a sponge full of sour wine on a hyssop branch and held it to his mouth. When Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, "It is finished." And he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Since it was the day of preparation, and so that the bodies would not remain on the cross on the Sabbath, for that Sabbath was a high day, the Jews asked Pilate that their legs might be broken and that they might be taken away. So the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and of the other who had been crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. But one of the soldiers who pierced his side with a spear, and at once there came out blood and water. He who saw it has borne witness, and his testimony is true, and he knows that he is telling the truth, that you also may believe. For these things took place, that the scripture might be fulfilled. Not one of his bones will be broken. And again, another scripture says, they will look on him whom they have pierced. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus the Christ. Amen. Yesterday, at our Monday-Thursday service, I shared about the importance of eating in both the Old and New Covenant. Passover, the peace offering, the Tree of Life, the manna. When God wants to give life to his people, he gives life. He puts life into something to eat. The Old Testament background of the Lord's Supper, in it we have life through Jesus, and we eat and drink his body and blood in, with, and under the bread and wine. I spoke of the lamb that was sacrificed and said that today on Good Friday, I would talk about the blood. In Genesis chapter 9, after Noah and his sons and their wives survived the flood and came out on the dry land, God blessed Noah and his sons and said to them, "Be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth. The fear of you and the dread of you shall be upon every beast. Into your hand they are delivered. Every moving thing that lives shall be food for you, and I give you the green plants, I give you everything, but you shall not eat flesh with its life, that is, with its blood." In Exodus chapter 12, at the feast of the Passover, God told the Israelites to take a lamb without blemish and a male a year old, to kill it and take its blood, and take some of the blood and put it on the two doorposts and on the lintel of the houses in which you eat of it. And they shall eat the flesh that night, seated, roasted on the fire, with unleavened bread they shall eat it. And when that night, when the angel of death would come over the land of Egypt, God says in chapter 12 of Exodus, "When I see the blood on the doorposts and the lintel, I will pass over you, and no plague will befall you to destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt." The significance of blood and forgiveness is seen in Leviticus chapter 17. God says, "If any one of the house of Israel or of the strangers who sojourn among you, among them, eats any blood, I will set my face against that person who eats blood and will cut him off from among his people. For the life of the flesh is in the blood. And I have given it for you on the altar to make atonement for your souls. For it is the blood that makes atonement by virtue of the life. Give me a moment here while I'm moving some pages around. I don't have enough of my plastic out to hold the papers on my stand. So what's up with all the blood in the Old Testament? In the Old Testament sacrifices, blood was more important than any other part of the animal. No part of the animal could be taken into the holy place or the holy of holies. It was to be brought to the altar, the fat portions of the animal were to be burned on the altar, and the blood was to be taken, sprinkled on the altar, and some once a year on the Ark of the Covenant in the Holy of Holies. Leviticus chapter 17 again explained the importance of blood. I have given you the blood on the altar to make atonement for your sins. It is the blood that makes atonement for the life. Again, for the life of the flesh is in the blood. An animal's life, we're told, is located in its blood. And when its blood has been let, it will die. Life is not an abstract thing. It is a visible fluid in the Old Testament. God says, I have given it to you. Our blood is a divine gift. The blood of every creature is a gift of God. The blood of Christ is the greatest gift of God. He is the giver of life. The blood not only has life, but conveys life. And this blood, God says, is to be on the altar, not just a place of death, but a place of forgiveness, a place of new life. And so always communion elements are placed on the altar, that the blood of Christ is for us the ultimate life-giving blood. By God's word of promise, that blood bestows ultimate holiness. He's given the blood to make atonement for our souls, our very life. The lifeblood of the victim brought for sacrifices in the Old Testament atones for the sinner. The lifeblood of Jesus removes our sin. The lifeblood of Jesus pays the penalty for our sin. His death becomes the death of all of us. And the requirement, the condemnation of sin is paid for. His life removes unholiness from us. At the Last Supper, Jesus says, drink of it, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. A real Christ, a real sacrifice, real blood, real life, real death, and real forgiveness, all on the cross of Jesus Christ. We see and have heard the words of his suffering this day as the passion story of Good Friday was read. We see his death on the cross. We'll hear shortly the seven last words of Christ from the cross, beginning with the first word, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Throughout the history of God's people, God has given the blood on the altar, on the sacred place, as the vehicle for the forgiveness of his people. And this day we celebrate the blood of Jesus Christ given on the cross, the new place of healing and wholeness given by God for the salvation of the world. And in this place, we see the death of the Messiah. I think I've always wondered by why Satan was fooled by the crucifixion, why he didn't see the resurrection coming. Because, and I think it's because every animal, when its blood was let throughout the whole history of the Old Testament, it had died and stayed dead. And his blood brought forgiveness for a particular sin. Somehow he did not envision, Satan did not envision, that the death of the Son of God and the shedding of his blood, and when the spear pierced his side and out came blood and water, Satan did not see that his forgiveness would not only pay for the sins of the people, but it would pay for the sins of all people for all time. And because of that, our sin is removed from us as far as the east is from the west. And now God has made us holy in the death of Christ. And there would never be the requirement of a death again. And so he died once for sin for all time. And now he rose from the grave and lives forever. Death never needing to be given, no more sacrifices being required, because his death has paid the price completely and fully for your sins. In him and by his blood, you are made new. We sing verses 1 through 3 of When I Survey the Wondrous Cross. The ultimate word. It remains the penultimate word. It remains only the penultimate word. There is one word yet to hear. We'll return on Sunday at 9 o'clock in the morning here in the parking lot, and at 11 o'clock in the morning in the sanctuary, with both services also being live streamed. But at this time, we return to this penultimate word, the seven last words from the cross. I had intended that after each word we would extinguish a candle, as we will do tonight in the sanctuary, but the wind this morning will not permit us to do that. They've already been extinguished. The first word from Luke 23. And when they came to the place that is called the skull, There they crucified him, and the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. And Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And they cast lots to divide his garments.
One of the criminals who were hanged railed at him, saying, Are you not the Christ? Save yourself and us. But the other rebuked him, saying, Do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we indeed justly, for we are receiving the due reward of our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong. And he said, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And he said to him, Truly, I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise.
The third word from John 19. But standing by the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When John saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to his mother, Woman, behold your son. Then he said to the disciple, Behold your mother. And from that hour the disciple took her to his own home.
The fourth word from Matthew 27 and Mark 15. Now from the sixth hour there was darkness over all the land until the ninth hour. And about the ninth hour Jesus cried out with a loud voice, saying, Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani? That is, my God, why have you forsaken me?
The fifth word from John chapter 19. After this, Jesus, knowing that all was now finished, said, to fulfill the scripture, I thirst. A jar full of sour wine stood there, so they put a sponge full of the sour wine on hyssop branch and held it to his mouth.
The sixth word from John chapter 19. When Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, It is finished. And he bowed his head and gave up his spirit.
And the seventh word from Luke 23. It was now about the sixth hour, 3 p.m, and there was darkness over the whole land until the ninth hour, 6:00. While the sun's light failed, and the curtain of the temple was torn in two, then Jesus, calling out with a loud voice, said, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. And having said this, he breathed his last. We join in singing the hymn, Lamb of God.
Lamb of God.
Jesus Christ,
the Lamb of God. I was so lost, I should have died, but you have brought me to your side.
Service, we continue with the special Good Friday prayers. They are, it's a bidding prayer where our worship assistant will invite us to pray and then I will lead us in the prayer.
Let us pray, brothers and sisters, for the whole Church of God throughout the world, that God the Almighty Father guide it and gather it together so that we may worship Him in peace and tranquility.
Almighty and eternal God, you have shown your glory to all nations in Jesus Christ. Guide the work of the Church. Help it to persevere in faith. Proclaim your name and bring salvation to people everywhere. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us pray for Bishop Dan Salvo, for our pastors and other ministers, for all servants of the Church, and for all the people of God.
Almighty and eternal God, your Spirit guides the Church and makes it holy. Strengthen and uphold our pastors and leaders. Keep them in health and safety for the good of the Church. And help each of us to do faithfully the work to which you have called us. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us pray for all our brothers and sisters who share our faith in Jesus Christ, that God may gather and keep together in one Church all those who know Christ as Lord.
Almighty and eternal God, you give your Church its unity. Look with favor on all who follow Jesus, your Son. We are all consecrated to you by our baptism. Make us one in the fullness of faith and keep us one in the fellowship of love. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us pray for the Jewish people, the first to hear the word of God, that they may receive the fulfillment of the covenant's promises.
Almighty and eternal God, long ago you gave your promise to Abraham and his posterity. Hear the prayers of your Church that the people you first made your own may arrive with us at the fullness of redemption. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us pray for those who do not believe in Christ, that the light of the Holy Spirit may show them the way of salvation.
Almighty and eternal God, enable those who do not acknowledge Christ to receive the truth of the gospel. Help us, your people, to grow in love for one another and become more perfect witnesses of your love in the sight of all people. Grant that in spite of the hurtful things that stand in their way, those who do not yet know Christ may all recognize in the lives of Christians the token of your love and mercy, and gladly come to faith and acknowledge you as the one true God and Father of us all. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us pray for those who serve in public office, that God may guide their minds and hearts so that all of us may live in true peace and freedom.
Almighty and eternal God, you are the champion of the poor and oppressed. In your goodness, watch over those in authority so that people everywhere may enjoy justice, peace, freedom, and a share of the goodness of your creation. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us pray that God, the Almighty and Merciful Father, may heal the sick, comfort the dying, give safety to travelers, free those unjustly deprived of liberty, and rid the world of falsehood, hunger, and disease.
Almighty and eternal God, you give strength to the weary and new courage to those who have lost heart. Hear the prayers of all who call on you in any trouble, that they may have the joy of receiving your help in their need. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. And together we pray the prayer our Lord Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We join in singing the first three verses of Were You There. Please note on the third verse, there's a misprint, and of course, we sing as we do always, the final words, Were You There, when they pierced him in the side.
Joseph of Arimathea, who was a disciple of Jesus, but secretly, for fear of the Jews, asked Pilate that he might take away the body of Jesus, and Pilate gave him permission. So he came and took away his body. Nicodemus also, who earlier had come to Jesus by night, came bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 75 pounds in weight. So they took the body of Jesus and bound it in linen cloths, with the spices, as is the burial custom of the Jews. Now in the place where he was crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden, a tomb, a new tomb, in which no one had yet been laid. So because of the Jewish day of preparation, since the tomb was close at hand, they laid Jesus there.
And they rolled the stone against the tomb. And we sing the final verse. Everyone who joined us today in the parking lot and online for our noon service on this Good Friday. We hope to see you again on Easter morning at 9 or at 11. God loves you, and so do I.